part of that, which we repeatedly do. And in looking back at Jim's life, and it's very strange for me, by the way, to call him Jim. Out of respect, I should be calling him Colonel Cox, but most of you know Jim, so I'll refer to him as Jim today. But we are that which we repeatedly do, and Jim Cox repeatedly served. And as you read his bio, you read his eulogy, it's his life story. He served you and I through service to first his country and by extension his family. And he did that at a great personal sacrifice. And I'm going to take a minute to read a few things and just put yourself in the shoes of this then young man as he goes through life making these decisions. What do? How do I serve my wife? How do I serve my family? How do I serve my nation? And it's not easy. I can tell you from someone who's been there that making these decisions is truly a sacrifice and truly a service to others. So he repeatedly did something. He flew airplanes. He flew them very well. He flew a lot of airplanes in a lot of different places, and I'm quite frankly very envious of the man. I find it funny that the advice that his father gave him when he left Oklahoma to go to school, does anybody remember that? Don't be a politician or a lawyer. Do whatever you want to do, but don't be a politician. Sorry, apologies to Tommy Dazio if you're in here somewhere. Any other lawyers or politicians. But that was his advice. He knew that Jim wanted to serve someone, but do it some other way. And so he went through school, he joined the Air Force, and found his way into pilot training. Advanced Air Force Base, it just so happens that was where my two oldest sons were born. In 1967, he flew a T-41, T-37, T-38, and then eventually graduated to fly an F-105, multiple different aircraft. Went to McConnell, worked at the tactical fighter wing in Thailand, then went on to Southeast Asia to fly 118 missions during the Vietnam War. That's 18 missions more than were required at the time. You could fly 100 missions and sign you off and you go home. Jim chose to stay, chose to serve, chose to repeatedly be something, and in this case, a servant to you and I, 18 more times than he had to. Comes home, gets reassigned, and at some point continues to see what some of the folks in this room will remember back in the 60s and early 70s. The TV didn't paint the war very well, and Jim felt compelled to go back and help the young men, his fellow pilots who'd been shot down, help them, serve them again by volunteering for a second tour in Vietnam. Very, very unusual at the time. But he did. He went back to Vietnam a second time, served with great distinction, in fact, earned a Distinguished Flying Cross. And for those of you who are not familiar with what we refer to as a DFC, what a DFC is, there's a pecking order with all the ribbons, right? Awards from the first, whatever, lowest to the most prominent, most of us familiar with the Congressional Medal of Honor. Well, the DFC happens to be the second highest award you can receive in our Air Force. And you do not do that just by virtue of showing up to work every morning, pouring yourself a cup of coffee, and sitting on a computer. He did some amazing things during those times, and that distinction is well deserved. I think his favorite part of his flying life was flying the F-15. Now, I'm an old F-16 pilot, and there's a tradition, a very competitive tradition amongst fighter pilots. And of course, we didn't have any enemies stateside to fight, so we had to train against someone. So typically F-16s would fight F-15s, and so we became very competitive. But in some other venue, I might share with you some of the stories, but they wouldn't be appropriate here. I'm sorry about that. There'd be a lot of this going on. And a lot of, no, it didn't happen that way. But I really enjoyed that with your grandpa. He loved doing that. And he loved serving you and I through that sacrifice. And so I'm grateful for that. When we lost Fran, that was a shock. I'm getting away from the Air Force side for a minute in the service. When we lost Fran, that was a shock to all of us. Jim, of course, most importantly. But through the grace of God, he met a beautiful lady across the street. And he saw fit to make that marriage happen. And Jim was a very different man, I'll tell you right now, very different person than that prior man of service that I'm trying to describe. He decided to serve one person, and I think he did quite well. And she, in turn, served Jim and saved Jim. People who know him in this room will agree. Jim was saved. Thank you. So, Aristotle knew what he was talking about. We are that which we repeatedly do. He did serve us, and for that I'm eternally grateful. Thank you all for being here.